In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Grace and power of Jesus Christ, and love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Today is the fifth Sunday of Lent. The theme for today's Eucharistic celebration, being aware of our own sinfulness. In the first reading from the book of Isaiah, the Lord directs us towards the experience of redeeming His people. Responsorial Psalm 126 is a song in praise of the Lord's marvelous deeds. In the second reading from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, Paul says that he counts all things as lost and focuses on one goal, Jesus Christ. In the Gospel from St. John, Jesus does not condemn the woman caught in adultery. Jesus' response to those who accuse the woman is more than a caution to us about making judgment of others. It is a profound lesson in divine mercy and forgiveness. As we participate in this Holy Mass, let us thirst to become triumphant Christians, just as our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us be redeemed by Jesus' compassion, to sin no more, and to live in God's love and peace, spreading the good news of salvation to all we meet.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins as failures, and so prepare ourselves to offer this Mass. I confess
to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my purses, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask the Saint Angel of the Church, O angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me.
Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
By your help we beseech you, Lord our God, may we walk eagerly in that same charity with which, out of love for the world, your Son handed himself over to death. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
The people I have formed for myself. my praises. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our response to the psalm is, what marvels the Lord worked for us, indeed we were glad.
What marvels the Lord worked for us, indeed we were glad.
What marvels the Lord worked for us, indeed we were glad.
Nothing can happen that without prayer the supreme advantage of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For him, I have accepted the loss of everything, and I look on everything so much rubbish if only I can have Christ and be given a place in him. I am no longer trying for perfection by my own efforts, the perfection that comes from the Lord. But I want only the perfection that comes through faith in Christ, and is from God and based on faith. All I want is to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, and to share his sufferings by reproducing the pattern of his death. That is the way I can hope to take my place in the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have become perfect yet. I have not yet won. But I'm still running, trying to capture the prize for which Christ Jesus captured me. I can assure you, my brothers, I am far from thinking that I have already won. All I can say is that I forget the past and I strain ahead for what is still to come. I'm racing for the finish, for the prize to which God calls us upwards to receive in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Fugu is the poisonous blowfish.
It's very dangerous to eat. Only the skilled person can cook this very expensive and delicious dish. I think our story today, the woman caught in adultery, is like that. It's very delicate, very sensitive. It's so delicate and very sensitive. Some of the early copies, early manuscripts of St. John did not include this story. Perhaps some of the early Christian communities could not understand the ease with which Jesus forgives or deals with this woman caught in adultery. It would have caused some scandalous situation. Some people would have misinterpreted the action of Jesus as accepting, approving the sin of adultery, condoning the action of this woman. It's more in line with the Gospel of St. Luke. So much so the scholars say, some of the early copies of St. Luke's Gospel carried this story and gradually found its way into the Gospel of St. John. St. Luke is very famous for Jesus' mercy, forgiveness, Jesus always taking the side of the women, the marginalized, the weakest people of the society. And he always stood by the sinners. So this story is more in line with the view of St. Luke's Gospel. However, we place, the church places this story as we are about to enter into the Holy Week. That is the reason. So let us enjoy the beautiful story of this woman caught in the The setting is that Jesus had been praying maybe overnight in the Mount of Olives, the Garden of Olives. Often he went to pray there. And then, at the early hours of the day, he comes to the precinct of the temple. The temple precinct becomes his pulpit. And people flocked to listen to him early hours of the day. And suddenly as he was preaching, there's a commotion. A group of people, we are told, scribes and the Pharisees, the group that always opposed Jesus, they bring a woman caught in the very act of adultery. Now imagine this situation. Early morning, she had been caught in the very act of adultery. Maybe she is half clad, we do not know. But this whole group of men dragging this woman and placing before Jesus, in the midst of everyone. What a painful, pitiful sight it would have been. And then they ask a question from Jesus. They know what to do. They know what the sin of adultery is all about. They know what Moses had told and what punishment they have prescribed. And they bring this woman. Wait a minute, there is something missing. No one can commit adultery all by oneself. Where is the other party? The Moses prescribes both the parties should be punished. Where is the man? So there is something fishy here. They not only want to shame this woman, but also they want to trap Jesus. So this woman is only the bait, the cat's paw. Their malicious intention is to trap Jesus. So when these people ask this question, what do you think about this? What shall we do with this woman? What is the response of Jesus? His response is a non-verbal communication. He bends down and with his finger he writes something on the floor. In fact, this is the only time in the scriptures we find that Jesus wrote something. There have been so many things written about Jesus, but he never left any writing except this instance where he bent down and wrote with his finger. Many scholars ask, what did he write? Well, some say that he wrote the sins of people who came to condemn this woman. We don't know. Some refer to the book of Deuteronomy, where we hear that God wrote the Ten Commandments with His finger on stone tablets. Now here, Jesus, the new Moses, writing the new law with His finger, not on stones, but on the sand. So that the winds of mercy can blow away, erase your sins. These are various interpretations. Some say that He wrote the word mercy, and mercy, that's all. But some other scholars would say, it's the wrong question to ask. We should not ask, what did He write? We should ask, why did He write? Well, it's a sign of disinterest that they are talking, but Jesus turning His attention to something else. As if He's saying, I'm not ready to fall into your trap. I know with what intention that you come bringing this woman to me. It's a sign of disengagement. And then they were persisting. They were asking Jesus, what shall we do? Then He raises His voice. He looks at them and says, let him who has not sinned cast the first stone. As if He's telling, you are using a lot of your energy to condemn this woman. Now why don't you use that energy to correct your own behavior? He is mirroring them back to them, their own consciousness. And then that pricked their own consciences. And one by one, beginning with the elders, they set the example. Beginning with the elders, they went away. And now the scene focused on Jesus and this woman. We are told that only Jesus and this woman was there. Reflecting on this scene, St. Augustine says something very beautiful. St. Augustine is very famous for playing with words. He wrote in Latin often. He says, only the miseria and misericordia left alone. Miseria stands for the misery. The misery, the miserable one, the woman. And misericordia, the merciful one. The Latin misericordia means merciful. Only the misery and the mercy were left alone. What a sensitive situation. What a delicate situation. This is what exactly Jesus does to each and every one of us. We are never left alone, even when we fail, even when we commit the most grievous act of sin. He stands with us. The whole society may leave us, but He stands with us, and He stood by this woman in this situation. The misery and the mercy. Misericordia means the misery in the heart. Cardia is the heart. So it's the pain in the heart. Jesus felt the pain, the misery of this woman in this heart. That is what mercy is all about. And then Jesus says, where are they? Then Jesus says, neither do I condemn you. All those people who try to condemn you are no more. Neither do I condemn you. Jesus never condones, accept the behavior, the action of this woman. Sin is a sin. Spade is a spade. You call it a spade. You can never call it not a sin. Jesus never condemns the sinner. He condemns the sin. He never condemns the sin. He only gives a mercy and acceptance to this. And that itself changed this woman. And finally, she is told, go away and never sin again. Dear friends, what we have here in the person of this woman is the humanity itself, you and me. We deserve death. We deserve punishment because of our sinful nature. But when we place ourselves in the presence of the all-merciful God, we are given a second chance. And that is what we hear, we read in our first reading. Through the prophet, God says, I am not interested in your past. Don't think about your past. Don't think about what gone before. What I need is here and now. So this is the first point. We need to take the responsibility for our action. We are responsible for our actions. To see, judge and act in every situation. And then, here is the good news. He is not interested about your past. Nobody can go and undo our past. Neither God expects you to do that. He is interested in your here and now, and that is why He gives you a second chance. He opens a new way before you, a new horizon before you. Therefore, take the responsibility of your action here and now and start correcting your behavior. This is the good news. And no matter how great your sin is, how sinful your past has been, it doesn't matter. What matters is here and now, and God is interested in your future. What you can become. The person that God wants you to be. Everyone has this potential. Therefore, never allow condemnation, the pointing finger, stop that flowering of yourself to become the person that you want to be. And Jesus forgives our sins. And forgiveness comes with a price. It's not easy. You know from our own experience how difficult it is to forgive. It involves detaching yourself from your powerful memories. So-and-so has done this to me. So-and-so has said this to me. So taking and putting it away is like taking a piece from you. It's your memory. It involves pain. It involves sacrifice at the end of the day. How much more the divine forgiveness cost? It cost more than that. Well, how much it cost? It cost more than a fugu dish in Japan. How much does it cost to forgive? Divine forgiveness. Well, the price can be seen on the cross. He paid with his very life. Therefore, this is a good opening to the Holy Week. Next week we are entering into the Holy Week with Palm Sunday. And Jesus invites all of us, just like this sinful woman, we are at the mercy of God. But remember, God stands with you. You are not alone. The misery and mercy. Mercy is always there for us. That's the new hope. Is there anyone here? So much trouble with one's past, thinking that God cannot forgive your past, then here is the good news for all of us. We have our ugly memories, sinful past, dark sides, dark patches of our life. But God never judges you with that. He gives you a second chance and another second chance. But it is also the challenge. The time is limited. Therefore, it's here and now. Offer yourself to Jesus. Accept yourself as you are. Take responsibilities for your action. Just like this woman, whole humanity is condemned. But Jesus is offering this gift of mercy and forgiveness. So look at the cross and appreciate the price that He paid and start working on our own behavior, on our own selves, on our own thinking and attitude of condemning others. Just like He told those people, let him who has not sinned cast the first stone. In other words, start using all your resources, energies, both psychological and spiritual, not to condemn others, but to correct your own behavior. I believe in one God,
Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
Have mercy, O Lord, on the prayers of your church, and turn with compassion to the hearts that bow before you, that those who make sharers in the divine mystery may never be left without your assistance. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your in our salvation. Always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you will that our self-denial should give you thanks, humble our sinful pride, contribute to the feeding of the poor, and so help us imitate you in your kindness. And so we glorify you with countless angels, as with one voice of praise we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice. Again, he gave him thanks and praise. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your faith, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, you may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis our Pope, Malcolm Ratcliffe our Bishop and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, St. Joseph, the spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have blessed you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours. Forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
the Savior's command, and formed by the divine teaching, we dare to say, Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin, safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I give you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity, in accordance with your will, to live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
To take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, to take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, to take away the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold Him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word.
Let us pray. We pray, Almighty God, that we may always be counted among the members of Christ, in whose body and blood we have communion, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Dear friends, a few announcements. As you know, the current situation in our country is rapidly changing. Let us pray honestly for the peace and harmony and stability in the country. At the same time, if the situation is conducive, the days are going back to normalcy, we will have a penitential service on Friday, on the 8th, from 5 to 8. That's a good start to enter into the Holy Week. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, we have the usual masses. And Friday, please make use of that time to come to church and make your confession. Receive the sacrament of reconciliation. So we have from 5 to 8 in the church. And secondly, on Saturday morning, that is on the 9th, the Archdiocese has proclaimed a prayer of solidarity, a day of prayer for solidarity in the country. We have invited the Anglican community at St. Stephen's Church, Rajagiriya, also to join with us. And we will have a short prayer service at 7 in the morning in our church, a combined prayer service together with the Anglican community. And thereafter, there will be a silent protest just to show our solidarity with the people who are suffering, which will be for about half an hour to 45 minutes. If everything goes well and if there is no curfew, we will go ahead with this program. So please tell your neighbors and the friends to come on Saturday morning at 7 a.m. to the church. We can show our solidarity and also displeasure towards the current situation that is going on in our country. Thank you and stay safe and stay blessed in our homes. I also thank the Claritian sisters today for giving us this opportunity, their space to celebrate this Mass. And also Karen once again for helping us with the singing. Thank you and stay blessed and God bless you. Bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bless, O Lord, your people who long for the gift of your mercy, and grant that what at your prompting they desire, they may receive by your generous gift. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And may the blessings of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in the peace of Christ.
Thanks be to God.